I'm sorry to tell you, but it doesn't end there.
You just getting started.
Just gotta get a little side of it.
They still stay at home, come home every once in a while, so.
That's fine.
Change.
I have a safety trip.
Good deal, good deal. And Germany's still standing, so we're done good. Anybody else this morning? That's it. Anybody got anything? Stephen, if you will you lift this up in prayer, we'll continue on.
Father, thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for everything you blessed us with. We are grateful for the rain. We're grateful for the graduates. We're grateful for all the people that are here, Lord, to come and worship you. But we just ask that you please be with those that are on the prayer list, Lord. You know what they're going through. You know what their circumstances are. Just be with them and also be with their families and those that are close to them, to just provide the peace and comfort to get through whatever they're going through, Lord. We just pray that you will is done for every situation, Lord. Marty, as you can bring the message and just be with us as we try to grow to serve you better, Lord. We love you and thank you for everything. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Page 132, let's all stand.
Thank you.
given each and every one of us. Lord, right now we ask that you just be forgiven and healed, Lord, that they both be blessed, and bring with Marty, he brings some blessings. And put us all in your son's beautiful and holy name. Amen.
Where the choice and you have to choose. I hope you choose the one. you make that?
Yes, I did.
Let's give Jimmy a hand.
Running out of ideas.
I want you to see mine at my funeral. You make me look as thin as Jackson does in pictures right now. So I definitely want you to get you to do that.
That's because Jackson is thin.
What's the mistake that you made? You want to tell these young men? I tell you what, I'm making it easy on you. One of y'all asked him for a word of advice on something. What about Ethan? You always good about some of those, huh? What you got to ask Jackson about? Girls. About girls? You want to ask about girls?
I can't get it.
You don't want to ask about girls?
Don't do it.
Care plenty of this.
Let me ask you this, and I'll ask you this in front of these kids. Are you where you want to be in life right now? Are you where you want to be in life right now? Good. So basically, what he's saying, kids, is when you get to the age that he is right now, at least be where you want to be. Be where you want to be. Be the person that God wants you to be. Be the person that life wants you to be. Be the person your parents want you to be. Because it does make a difference. It does make a difference. Now, Billy Joe and Diana both have two kids they can be very proud of. Very proud of. Do we all have faults?
Yep.
Sure.
Yes,
and we all have some bad times. Sure we have. We're not going to be perfect. We're going to make mistakes. But coming back to your Savior is the first place you go when you make the mistake that you make. And that's something I just want to share with everybody. So kid, Ziggy, goes from all the way to Jamie, Kyle, all the way over the other lane. Very important. And Lee, you too. As a young man that's, I think, done very well in life so far, and I thank you for the Lord blessing him with a long life, he's going to make something of himself. And I want each and every one of you to look at him and say, you know what? Jackson looks like he's got all of his ducks in a row. And maybe he's somebody that we need to talk to. Maybe he's somebody we need to ask questions of every once in a while, because he's done went down a road that each one of y'all are fixing to go down. So let's remember that. Alan, you next. Next. Thank you. Have a seat. Y'all sit down. I got to thinking about, and when it comes to giving advice, I got to thinking about it, and you know what? I started thinking about my life, and I started thinking about me growing up, and I started thinking about the life that I had at home and things like that. And I just got to a point, I said, you know what? Maybe I ain't the person to give Jackson advice. Maybe the advice I had, maybe Jackson's already beyond. I can honestly say I think that Jackson is more mature now at 18 years old than I was at 18 years old. I mean, I don't mind admitting that. I mean, you know, I'm not so prideful that I can't admit that I was a very young man at 18 years old. And I'm thinking to myself, he's 18, so what should I say to Jackson today that is going to help him along his way? And you know what? I'm not worthy to give him advice. I'm not. I've made a lot of mistakes in my life, as well as a lot of people in here have made mistakes. So when we turn to advice, we want real advice. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to read a few verses for you today. And these few verses, we're going to kind of break down just a little bit. And I'm going to give you these verses today in a way that God gave them to me. Okay? So I want everybody to turn with me, if you will, to the book of Exodus, chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20. You already got that Bible? That's what I'm talking about. That's good. Right there. That's good. You want a pen? You want to go ahead and write some notes in? You can mess it up right now. You want a pen? We're going to be in Exodus chapter 20, and I'm going to go back a little old school on y'all this morning, even though it's something that I don't do and I don't practice weekly in this church. I'm going to actually go back today and read from King James, because when I was a young lad growing up, when I heard the Ten Commandments, I heard them in King James. That's the way I heard them. I always heard King James. And when I think of, even now, when I think about the Lord's Prayer, I still hear the Lord's Prayer in King James. That's the way I talk about it. So I want to read something to you today. And in Exodus chapter 20, verse 1, it says, "And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." Exodus 23 says, "Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or likeness of any living thing that is in heaven above, or that is in earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days might be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Let us pray. God, as we come to you now, I pray that we can take your commands and we can introduce it to a generation, Father, that it needs it so desperately. To a group of kids that are in this church today, to a group of adults that's in this church today that are raising these kids. Father, just to remember your Ten Commandments. Not in a way of having to live by them in order to come see you, but in a way to live by them so that we can be seen by others as being your children. So, Father, today I ask that you take these Ten Commandments and you shower Jackson today, Lord, with the blessings that only you can give. And you comfort him in only the way that you can. And that you hold him in your hand, the same hand that holds the world, so he can be secure, he can be sincere, he can be serious, and he can be saved by only a Father in heaven that loves him so in the way that you do. And we ask these things only in Christ's name. Amen. I want to share with you today, I actually took the Ten Commandments and I put them in line, so if you're trying to keep up, it probably got a little confusing for you, but I want to just talk to you a little bit. I'm not doing anything fancy today. We've already had some time out. I know a lot of y'all ready to eat, but I want to go through and I got to think about what better advice than God's advice? Amen. What better way to set down a set of rules and regulations than God's rules and regulations? But I want to have a little fun first. Jackson, how many commandments is it? Okay? You sure about that? You're absolutely positive. It's 10 commandments. Okay, that's what you thought? Okay. All right. Yeah. Somebody want to start counting? Let's count. Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to thee. Thou shalt not take the Lord's name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day. Honor thy father and father. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. 11. What the Bible says. Somebody said, you're on stage, you're crazy. No, what the Bible says. So I read that this morning, and I said, whoa! I said, did I see the 11 commandments with Charlton Heston years ago, or the 10 commandments? It was the 10 commandments with Charlton Heston years ago. So just so we can clear up all any misconceptions, it says in the book of Deuteronomy that God gives down 10 commandments in his 10. And what you have is some Bibles will word them different ways and change it out. But what I want to share with you this morning is that Exodus 20 and 4 and Exodus 20 and 5 actually goes as one command. Okay? Basically what it's telling you to do is do not make any graven image, do not make a false idol, and then do not worship it. Okay? So those two are going to go hand in hand. I just want to have that little bit of fun with you this morning. Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. If your Bible has God with a capital G, throw it away. Because it says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Gods is a little G. And what that means is there is no God other than the God of Isaac, of Abraham. There is no God other than that. You can talk about gods all you want to, but they will always have a little G. God, our Father in heaven, capital G, Jackson. Capital G. Always. Always capital G. It is so easy to put things before our capital G. It's so easy for life to get a hold of us. And the next thing you know, we've forgotten about our capital G. So I just want to tell you right now, do not have any gods before God. Don't do that. Don't do it. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. I'll talk to y'all about this for a little bit. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness, or any living thing that is in heaven above, or is in earth beneath, or is in the water of the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord God, am a jealous God. Let me tell y'all something. Oprah Winfrey can say that there's no such thing as a jealous God. Oprah Winfrey don't know God.
That's right.
And I'll tell you why. God created this earth that we're on. God created the waters, the heavens, the land, the air. God created the animals. God created the man that walks this earth. Everything belongs to Him. All of it, there's no other that does not belong to God. And when you take something and put it in God's place, and that's what you put before Him, guess what you just got introduced to? A jealous God. And the scripture says that He is even admitting Himself that I am a jealous God. You know what that means? There ain't no putting God in second place. First place. But I want to talk to you about these things called graven images. A graven image is anything that has been carved, chiseled, or cast to be in the likeness of something else. But what does it mean when we cast something? Cast, you're talking about a flower. He works at Georgia Iron Works.
You might mold.
Yeah, mold. There we go.
You might have my picture of it.
The only one I thought I could call on that might know what cast actually was, because he works with it every day and he talks about a piece of paper. When you cast something, you take a mold and you pour liquid metal into it. And then when that liquid metal goes into something, it takes the form or the shape of what the actual sculpture is inside. Okay? That's casting something. Another form of casting is when you stamp out something. Okay? When you take an emblem of something and you put it on what they call a die, and then you put a piece of metal under this die and you come down on it and you stamp on it, you've just cast something. You cast the image of whatever is on that die onto whatever that piece of metal is. That's casting. But it says, a graven image is anything that has been carved or chiseled or cast to be the likeness of something else. Does money have an image on it? How about that? What's some of the images we see on money? What's some of the presents we see on money?
Washington.
I said Washington. Who? You don't know.
Benjamin Franklin.
How long will that?
An eyeball
is on there. That's exactly right.
Pyramid.
Let me ask you this.
Pyramid.
I'm gonna share something with you. And all y'all folks as mentors, don't you know nothing to me, because I don't mean it this way. Just bear with me. Has any of you ever got an eagle on it? Yeah. Have we ever seen something cast or stamped out that's got an eagle on it? I'm gonna share something with you, and I'm gonna share it from the bottom of my heart. Be careful how patriotic you are. Because this United States is not worth putting before God. And what I mean by that is, I wish that in this nation right now, that the people that I see that are so beyond patriotic, it's unbelievable, would be the same people that won't show up at church on Sunday. Let me tell you something, if you want to be patriotic, that's great. I'd go get that thing Billy rides around in that he has for no reason whatsoever. I'd go get in here with American flags, and I'd ride through the middle of any city in the United States and be just as proud as I could be. But I'm not going to put that flag before my God.
No, sir.
I'm not going to do it. So be careful how patriotic you are. Be careful what message you present. Because there is nothing more important than your relationship with the Lord. But I want to talk to you about something else too. That eagle that's on that money, don't let that money become your God. Don't let that money take the place of your Savior. Don't let that money put you in a place to where you're actually jeopardizing the relationship you have with Him in a way to where you're not walking with Him. Don't let that money do that. It ain't worth it. It ain't worth it. The money's not worth it, folks. To have every riches in the world but have not the Lord, you are going to die. And you're going to be in a place that Jesus ain't. And we don't want you that. And there's been so many people in this world that have gotten hung up in this thing about money. And the next thing you know, they're not even at church no more because the money's so important. I'm not telling you if you work a shift work or if you gotta work nights or something like that and you can't make it on Sunday morning, that's fine. Let me tell you something. There's more days than Sunday morning that you come to church if you can't make it on Sunday morning, okay? Every day you spend with the Lord at church is important. So therefore, if you have to work on Wednesday night, you work on Wednesday night. But when you can, and God provides you an opportunity to come to His house, come to His house. And that's why I appreciate you so much, because you've been here. You've been here many Sunday night. You sit right back down where Maggie's sitting there right now. And the only reason anybody would know you were here, because I've had to remind them, hey, Jackson's in the house. Jackson, answer a question for me. And he was looking at Lisa and go, hmm. And then she would get mad at me because I was being asked her. But being in the Lord's house, don't let that graven image take the place of God. It's not worth it. It is so not worth it. The old gospel song we were talking about the other morning in Sunday school, the last suit you wear will not have no pockets. Won't be needed. Thou shalt not take the name of thy Lord God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guilty to that taketh his name in vain. Well, we talked about that this morning in Sunday school. Ain't it amazing we talked about Sunday school this morning? I want to share something with you. I want to share something with you about what this is telling me and what the way I need to say it. Everybody says if you say GD, you're going to hell in a box swing, okay? And that's the concept that everybody's got. If you say GD, you done took the Lord's name in vain, it's all over with you. You know, you just well strap a bowling ball to your butt because you're going straight down. Well, it ain't like that. Okay? It don't work like that. There's a lot of people that said GD is going to heaven. I happen to be one of them. If you know what it means, don't say it anymore. Okay? But I want to share something else with you. We talked about a lot of great things this morning and we got some folks right now that's questioning their own ability to have conversation because of the words that we talked about this morning. But let me tell you something. Do not use His name in any way except to honor Him. Do not use His name in any way except to honor Him. Oh my God, did you hear what He just said? See, that's wrong. You ain't supposed to say that. That's bad. You don't use the Lord like that. You don't say, I swear to God. No, you don't do that either. You can't swear to something that you have no control over. You use God's name in a way that honors Him, that exalts Him, that praises Him, that worships Him, that acknowledges Him. So Ron's going to keep close dibs on you. Fool around and let that ring slip and pop you right there. Ron, why don't you tell me what he says? Share a story with y'all. I have a dear, dear friend that's a pastor in Big Step Door. His name is Jim Harris. And he worked with Conquerors for Christ. I don't know if anybody's ever been involved with him. But it's a group of men that go out and actually build houses and stuff for other people. And they do it as a mission. And they do it as a giving. And they serve him. And much like the same way with fire department, you're a volunteer fireman, correct? All right, well, these guys go out, they volunteer their time, their resources, their efforts. So it was him and about 10 other preachers in a room one day. And they're all in there and they're building this house and they're working on this room and you got boards going all the way and nails and you got hammers, bam, 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 and all these people are working, walking in and out. And by that time you heard bam, 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 thump, damn it! And he said the room got real quiet for about 10 seconds. And then all of a sudden, bam, 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 bam. God's not going to send you to hell to say an ugly word, folks. He's not going to do it. He's going to send you to hell when you don't accept the Son. That's when He's going to send you to hell. We're not perfect. You will not be perfect. As much as your mama claims that you are. custom now, that on certain occasions, when I walk in the door of the church, am I that truthful? She does not. She does it with you too. Yeah, she does. Look at my baby. Look at my baby. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to say ugly words. We're going to make mistakes in life. But you know what? We have a God that is a gracious God. And we have a God that is a forgiving God. And we have a God that loves us no matter how big mistakes are to be made. But folks, we've got to remember that He's got the power to forgive us if we only will forgive ourselves. So any mistake you make in life, God's going to forgive you for. Matter of fact, you're already forgiven. You're already forgiven if you notice. So I wanted to share with you the fact that it might be okay some, you know, it's never okay to let it slip. But a Christian who walks around using the Lord's name in a way unworthy of God is a Christian that's walking down a mighty, mighty rough road ahead with mighty, mighty enemies. And I'm telling you now, watch what you say. But if you sit up in this church and you have Sunday mornings or Sunday nights and you're wearing the right clothes, you got the right look in the whole yard, whole 9 yards, and you flew around and go to Ron Shop, and you get back there with them boys, or you get out on the road and you represent this church in Ron Shop, and you say something that's unbecoming of your Father in heaven, who's going to know you? And the way they're going to know you is by what you just said, not by you going to church. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. You know, there's a lot of people that want to keep this one around. There's a lot of people that want to take it and make their own thing. There's a lot of people that want to say, well, I can't come because of this, and I can't come because of that. But I want to share something with you. I want to share something with you today about what keeping the day, God's day, means. It means we all need to set aside time for God to rest, to pray, to meditate on His Word, to praise Him. And this is where it's going to become very uncomfortable for Jackson. This cannot be done in a boat, in a deer stand, in a hunting fly of any kind. This needs to be time fully devoted to God. I'm going to share something with you. I've tried. As a pastor of a church, I will be the first to admit that I've taken my Bible and my phone and a little piece of paper and went and sat on a gas line and a tree stand. And my intention was to hunt and prepare my lesson for that coming Sunday. You know what ended up happening? I hunted. You know why? I was not devoted time to God. I was trying to kill two birds with one stone. It does not happen. If you go sit in the woods, don't you dare tell me this is where I have my church, because you just told a lie. You do not have church sitting in the woods in this time. You do not have church sitting on the lake in a boat. You do not have church out there. You have church in God's house with God, or you have church with God. You do not have it with God and anything else. It does not happen. Because I could have a little Bible out, I could be flipping through it. And Moses went to the Israelites and it. I don't know what this does. In a different world. But the point of the matter is, don't tell lies. Don't be acting like that you're in church just because you're sitting in the woods. Well, I spend my time with the Lord. And no, hush. God knows better than that. Who do you think you're really fooling? Need to be in church. Need to be in church. It says a holy day. It doesn't say a hunting and holy day. Keep the Sabbath what? Keep the Sabbath holy. You know, that's the hardest day for me to keep holy. It really is. You know why? Because sometimes I work harder on Sunday than I do any other day of the week. It's tough. It's tough. It really is. But you know what? God still loves me. And He'll still love you. He still does love me. Honor thy father and mother. I can just have a ball, but I'm not going to do it. Honor thy father and mother that thy days may be long, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord hath given thee. Okay, so if I want to preach this the way you like it, that means that if you honor both of them, they're going to give you a bunch of land. Is that what that sounds about you? He says yes.
And it says, you're going to live a long time too.
Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord has given thee. Look, I'm going to take the young's approach on this. Every parent in here is not perfect. Okay? I didn't have perfect parents. Stephen don't have perfect parents. Scott didn't have perfect parents. Buck didn't have perfect parents. Miss Nancy, you didn't have perfect parents. Glenn, you did not
Jimmy
have perfect
has
parents.
A perfect parent.
Isn't that another one of the commandments, not the lie?
I'm getting that just a little bit, so I'm going to call Miss Nancy down. Just because your parents are not perfect don't mean that you shouldn't love them and honor them. It doesn't mean you have to live by the rules and regulations and standards that they do. If you got a parent that's on pills, that don't mean you got to be on pills. If you got a parent that's on the bottom, it don't mean that you got to be on the bottom. It doesn't. If you got a parent that has committed a sin that the church deems unworthy even to be a Christian anymore, doesn't mean you got to follow suit, folks. Doesn't mean you got to follow suit. But you know what it does mean? It means you still got to love them. Amen. It means you still got to be there for them. Now, I want to share something with you. I want to tell you, I'm blessed to actually live that has two parents that love me. Because everybody don't get it. For crying out loud, everybody don't have two parents anymore. But my dad is getting to the age now where I'm fixing to start having to do things for him. And I know a lot of you are at that age where you possibly got kids that's fixing to start doing things for you. But here's the deal. It doesn't matter how I was raised, or who I was raised with, or in what conditions I was raised in. My God in heaven tells me I'm supposed to honor my father. And you know what? If he calls me and he needs me for something, I'm going to honor that. No matter what conditions I've been in my past, and what kind of father he's been, or what kind of son I've been, because believe me, I wasn't one that anybody would want. But you still have to honor your father. It doesn't mean you have to honor all their wishes. It does not mean that you have to honor everything that they want. You have to honor them and be there for them when they need you. One of these days, your mom's going to need you. One of these days, your dad's going to need you. And it's going to be a situation where probably it's going to be uncomfortable and it's going to be inconvenient sometimes. You know what? God's word says you're supposed to honor them. And you're supposed to be there for them. And I don't want to see the day come when Billy Joe's got to call and you say, Jackson, come on here, buddy, I got to try and get this moving. I just ain't able for it. I don't want to see that. Nobody wants to see that. But it's coming. It's coming. My dad fixed to go in surgery at the end of this month. You know, Dad's going to have an open heart surgery. I mean, how many of us in here can relate to seeing a parent get older? Hey, it's part of it. It's part of it. And even though sometimes we can just, that's the biggest amen I've ever got out of Felicia this whole time. She said amen, that eye I've got big. I thought she was fixing to get one of these. We're supposed to love them. Supposed to love them. Supposed to be there for them. I don't care who they are. It don't mean you're supposed to support what they're involved in. But if they need you, you're supposed to be there for them. Honor thy father, thy father, and mother. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not kill. You said you ain't got a problem with that right now, right? I mean, everything's still okay. Okay. I guarantee you've already broke some man. As well as everybody in here. What's Jesus saying in the book of Matthew? In the book of Matthew, to save time, you know what he says? He says, my father says, don't kill anybody. He says, my father says, don't kill anybody. And he said, you know what? If you've held hatred in your heart towards someone, you kill them. You committed murder. You ever felt a little bit upset towards somebody? Oh, yeah. Now we're getting to the real thing. You ever been upset with somebody, Jackson? Yeah. Yeah, you have. You ever turned red? You got the way you can't talk? Yeah. So here's the deal. If you hold that kind of hatred, that kind of anger in your heart comes towards someone, Christ took God's commandment and actually raised the bar on it.
You ain't got to take a life, you can just hate a life. And you broke the commandment. Don't do it, it's not worth it. Being angry at someone is like giving, is like taking poison and expecting them to die from them. That's what being angry is. Thou shalt not commit adultery. These last four, I want to talk to y'all about something. These last four is something that we need to listen to so much, because there's so much being said right here about selfishness. There's so much. I didn't realize until I actually started doing a study on the Ten Commandments about how much of the Ten Commandments involves selfishness and involves self. Listen to what it says. It says, thou shalt not commit adultery. Well, you know what committing adultery is? It's when you go after somebody else because you ain't pleased with what God's given you. That's what committing adultery is. Period. You can paint it whatever color you want to paint it. There's no other way to paint it other than the fact you just done went out and you done stepped out on the person that God's given you. So I want to talk to you about this. I know you're sitting right there, and I don't mean any fun or any jokes or whatsoever. I'm being just as dead serious as I can right now, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart. If I stood here and tried to sugarcoat this, I'd be doing you wrong. Be content with who God gives you, but make sure it's who God wants you to have. You think about it. And everybody else, all you young kids coming up, be content with who God gives you, but make sure it's who God wants you to have. Make sure it's the one that God has chosen for you. Make sure it's somebody that you can walk alongside of with Jesus Christ as a common denominator with. Because I'm going to tell you something. You can try to save the world if you want to, one person at a time, and each one relationship at a time. But you know what? There comes a day when if you want to get real serious about a relationship, you got to get with somebody to know Jesus the way you do. Now, I'm just being honest with you. So, Jackson, not meaning anything between you two at all. I mean no disrespect. Don't know the business, don't care. My point is to make sure that in life, that when you have the person that God wants you to have, that you honor that person by staying with that person. Because it's all about honoring the one that you made the vow with. If the vows were made as a common denominator of Jesus Christ as being them. Thou shalt not steal. That means if you go in the wrong shop and you just don't really feel like doing a whole lot one day, and you say, hey, I need to go to the store because I don't really feel like doing anything, ain't got errands or something, you got me to run, and Ron sends you to Atlanta. I think he's done that before, hasn't he, Diane?
Yes.
He
sent you to Atlanta.
Yeah. Hey, Ron, tell us, sometimes you got to do what you got to do. Sometimes you just got to roll with it. You know what do not steal means? It means if Ron sends you to Atlanta to go get a part, and while you're in Atlanta, you want to drop by and see a movie, just intending you were sitting in traffic? No. That's stealing. If you're on the clock and you're not doing what your boss needs you to do, and you're not helping your boss in a way because he's paying you to do that, then you're stealing. You're stealing. Every one of us give that. Every one of us give that. I think the thing we used to do is play cards. We did. We play cards.
Gamble.
Play spades. I'm tough when it comes to playing spades. You know why? I play a lot of spades. But the point of the matter is this. If we wasn't doing what our boss man told us to be doing. And Jimmy was recording this, he'd find out today. Well, it's too late to find out now, but hey, you know, I can go back and ask him to get this later on. But the point is this. If you're getting paid to be doing something, be doing something. Be doing something. If you find something laying on the ground and you know whose it is, it ain't yours. It's somebody else's. Very simple. Very simple. All right, let's get things done. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. You have two ears and one mouth for a reason. Two ears and one mouth for a reason. We would all be better off if we would keep our mouth shut and quit talking to folks. I don't care who they are or what they've done. That's their business. It's between them and the Lord. Unless you go to them in a way that you're being compassionate and you want to talk to them and try to help them from the bottom of your heart, come on. Keep your mouth shut. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that's in thy neighbor's house. Again, be content with what God has given you. Who is your neighbor? Is it the person that lives in the house next to you? No. No. Brandon is Buck's neighbor. Brandon lives in Mitchell, which is like a long way away from anything. Buck lives in Lincoln, in Loco. But they're still neighbors. Still neighbors. I don't care where you live, you have neighbors all around you. Anybody that you know that you come in contact with is your neighbor. Me and my wife had a conversation this morning. We talked about it in Sunday school class, and Stephen and Diane just jumped all over it. It was really, really cool. But it says in the New Testament, they asked Jesus what was the most powerful commandment, what was the greatest of the commandments, and Christ said, first, honor thy God, all your heart, soul, and mind. And second, he said, what did he say? Love thy neighbor as yourself. You know what? That's not a commandment. That's not one of the Ten Commandments. But what did Christ do by saying, honor your neighbor as you would yourself? He took care of the rest of the commandments. I just say that. What does it say? Thou shalt not take no another, or move it down. Here we go. Honor thy mother and father. Treat them like you want to be treated. Thou shalt not kill. Nobody, you don't want nobody killing you. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Don't nobody want to be cheated on. Okay? Thou shalt not steal. Don't nobody want to have none stolen from them. Thou shalt not bear false witness. How many people like being talked about? If you raise your hand, you got issues. Now, some people intentionally do things to be talked about, but that's not what I'm talking about. For those, there's another sermon on another day. And don't covet your neighbor's house, your wife, or your neighbor's wife. Don't do these things. This is about selfishness. Christ said, honor God, love God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you do both of those things, all these commandments are taken care of.
Amen.
Every one of them taken care of. Is it hard for you to love people that you don't know? Tell the truth. It is. You know what? Doesn't matter to God. Doesn't matter to God. Is it hard for you to love people that you don't like? Is there anybody that you know of, you think of right now that you don't like? Plenty of them. That means you got plenty of people tomorrow to go cover that you love them.
I won't see them.
You ain't gonna say that?
I won't see them.
Oh, you ain't gonna see them tomorrow, okay. Can you call them? Can't call them. Look, thank you for being who you've been. And I pray that God continues leading you in your life. I want you to be a person that will be in this church in a capacity years from now. So I'm going to finish with this question for you. Who do you want to be in this church 10 years from now? I want you to answer it right now. Do you want to be Jackson that comes and sits on a pew, listens to the preacher, goes back home? Or do you want to be somebody that's going to be serving the Most High King? You don't have to answer it, but you should. As a matter of fact, everybody in here should have to answer it. Well, who do you want to be in 5 years? Who do you want to be for God? Do you want to know Him if you don't know Him now? Because the question is, the most important question is, do you know Him now? If you don't, that's the first priority. Second priority is, if you know it, act like it. Actually become the person that God wants you to be. Do the thing God wants you to do. I heard one of the greatest testimonies I've ever heard in my life. I bet, can you pronounce his last name? She's a Chiavelle? Chiavelle, Jim Chiavelle? It's the guy that played the Passion for Christ. You know how to pronounce his last name? I think, yeah, but he's got a kind of a funny name.
He also plays Luke in the new movie Paul.
Yeah. Guy's got a great testimony. He says something. He says, being free don't give you the right to do what you want. He says, being free gives you the right to do what you ought. Is that not cool? I'm telling you today, if you claim freedom in Jesus Christ, He's giving you the right to do what you ought. And I think everybody in here needs to do what we ought. Let's pray. Father, we come to you now. Thank you for this time, Father. I thank you for Jackson. I thank you for his attendance. I thank you for his love for the church. I thank you for his volunteer and fire department. I thank you for the graduation he's got coming up. I thank you that he's just a young man in your house today, Lord. What a testimony just to be in your house today. Father, I thank you for all these many things. I thank you for this day that you've given us. I thank you for all the visitors that have come out to see Jackson this day. I thank you for his life. And Father, I thank you in advance for the serving that he knows he needs to make for you in the future. Father, if there's anybody in here now that's a little bit confused about what's been said, about this relationship thing between you and them, Father, if there's anybody in here now that's not really sure about their relationship with you, may you prick at them. May the Holy Spirit of you prick at them or prod at them in a way, Lord, that it makes them start asking questions about this relationship or the lack of it. So, Father, I ask you today just to continue to bless Billy Joe and Diana and Felicia and Jackson in their life, in their walk, in their ways, in their moves, in their talk. And continue to comfort them in the only way you can. Bless them in the only way you can, Lord. And provide in the only way that you can. And we ask these things all and in and through the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
300. It's all saved.
She thinks my tractor's sexy. Ooh. I hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow. Road leads you where you wanna go, and if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, more than anything, I hope you know somebody loves you. And you never look back, but you never forget all the ones who love you in the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake.